We're talking about worldview versus a biblical worldview. And, you know, everything that Jordan shared this morning all falls into an understanding of how you view things in this world. You're either going to view it secularly, like the world views it, or you're going to view it like God views it. And the only way we understand how God views things that are happening in the world and things that are happening to us is through understanding who He is through the Word of God. It's critical, as I said last week, we have to have a biblical worldview today, because what's happening in the church is there is a secular movement coming under the guise of Christianity, and it has a secular worldview, and it looks at Scripture through the world's eye. They know how to take Scripture, they know how to twist it, they know how to package it, repuke it out, right? And get you to believe what they're saying. And that's why we have to know the Word of God. If we don't know the Word of God in these days, the enemy is busy trying to separate the church from truths and lies. And so I'm going to give you a brief introduction to a world, biblical worldview college class. So I'm just going to read it. Says this: a worldview is the structure of understanding that we use to make sense of our world. Our worldview is what we presuppose. Goes on to say, the worldview includes how we process events, news, and experiences, and how we arrive at our conclusions, how we make our decisions, and how we determine our actions and responses. All of these are structures. Usually when a decision is made, it is made on the basis of a pre-existing belief or assumption. Do you understand this morning that your pre-existing beliefs or assumptions don't always line up with God's heart? And it's important for us to know that today. Let's pray. Father, we come before you right now in the precious name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that you would use my mouth, you'd use my heart, my spirit, the words that you place in me to come out today effectively, so that we can see the importance of who you are, the importance of your word in everything we do in our life. In Jesus' name, amen. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at an entire book of Psalms. One entire book today. Relax, it's not 119. It is actually, otherwise we'd be here a long time. However, 119 is an actual, absolute wonderful psalm. It's got like 160 verses in it, and it's all about God's ways and how we're to delight in them, even the ones that hurt. Amen? So one thing that's important to understand about Psalms is this. Psalm chapter 1 sets a precedent for a lot of Psalms. Come on. It sets a precedent for it all. Because its center comes upon God's Word. Right from the very get-go. The first one, it centers around this idea of God's Word, and those that eat it, consume it, they won't be dead people. They won't be people who are just trying to drag their body through life, but they will be prosperous people. We'll get into it. But we're going to read the whole thing right up front. And it says this. Verse 1. Blessed is the man who walks not, everybody say not, in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the paths of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bring forth fruit in its season. Those leaves also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand, in the judgment, nor sinners. Am I missing something here? The problem when you start using magnifiers, it messes your vision up. There we go. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. So right now, I want to just take a look at that first word, blessed. Everybody say blessed. Blessed is the man or woman. Blessed is the man or woman. And so if you look at the Hebrew word, in the Hebrew, there's two basic words that are used for blessed. The first one is baruch, which is the traditional word to express blessing. The other word is esher, which can be blessed, but's better translated as happy. Happy is the man. Happy. Everybody say happy. Now, don't get happy tied up with how the world looks at the word happy, because happy, a lot of times, is all contingent on circumstances, right? How many of you know that you can be a happy Christian in the worst of storms? Because it's a choice. And the reason you can be happy in the worst of storms is because your trust isn't in the storm, your trust isn't in yourself, your trust is in the right arm of God who can save. Your trust is in the fact that He is our refuge, that we can run into and be safe in the storm. Come on. There's going to be storms that are going to come in all of our lives. And all of us in here have probably experienced some form of a storm in our life. Storms aren't meant to kill you. They're meant to get you to understand how you can make it. Not on your power, not in your strength, but in God's, and resting in Him. So this psalm begins by describing someone, again, like I said, a male or a female, who is experiencing happiness. Okay, now, let's get this very clear today. Happiness is not merely pleasure. Come on, it's not merely pleasure. This is a description of a long-term state of happiness, which we would call joy. Long-term happiness is actually joy. And it's not produced by what you think. It's not produced on what you get. It's not produced on what you can buy. It's joy, because our joy comes from the Lord. Amen? So let's break this down. The happy and full of joy Christian does not, everybody say does not, walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. Now get this. Let's read that again. The happy and full of joy Christian does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. It is a natural progression that once you start talking, taking advice from the wicked, you'll begin to think like them. You'll begin to act like them. That's why, can I say it? That's why it's important when we're going through things, is that we go to somebody who is a believer that stands on the Word of God, that can stand with you in faith that you can get through this. We don't need to go outside of the church and talk to secular people, because you're going to get a secular response. And the secular response won't deal with the root issue of what's going on. Many times what the secular world does is it tries to deal with the symptom and not the root of what's happening in our life. Come on, can I hear an amen? Do you know that we all sit here today and we got things going on in our life? And what usually manifests is the manifestation of that. And so we try to make that not happen. We try to suppress that action. And we may be able to do that, but you don't deal with the root. You deal with the root, the action will go away. And so a lot of times we don't change what's inside us. We try to change an expression. We try to change an outward action. God's not interested. Listen closely, God's not interested that you change the outside. Because even Jesus said, men are like a bunch of whitewashed tombs. They look great on the outside, but they're rotten bones on the inside. God's not looking for us to look good and beautified on the outside. He's looking at our heart. He's looking at where the seed of everything's at in our life, and He's looking at the roots there that He wants to take an axe to. That He wants to take his word to, His scalpel to sever that. You sever that, you sever the action. Come on, it's a root issue. And we all have them. Now get this. Not to bore you today with Hebrew words, but sometimes they're a great study. Like it says, walks in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the path of sinners. That word path, Derek, you'll like this, is Derek. It's not actually pronounced Derek. It's spelt like Derek, D-E-R-E-K. But it's Derith. And it's significant here, because a lot of times we look at a path as like a way we walk, but in the Bible it actually means lifestyle. It means lifestyle. It's not like a direction you're going, right? Like, how many of you guys driven on the road before and you've seen signs that say turn here and you turn there? It's not a direction. It's actually a lifestyle that we live. It encompasses all that we are. It encompasses on how we, what we say, what we think, what we do, how we act, and how we appear towards one another and to the world outside. It is a way of life. So when we look at that word path, it's just not making a turn, it's having a lifestyle, right? And the only way to live this lifestyle with the worldview of the Bible and filtering it through a biblical worldview is we've got to be on God's path. We can't be on our own path. We can't be doing our own thing. We can't be doing, like Jordan said, hey, my friends are doing it. It's all good. No, it's not okay. It's not okay, and that's some of the issue that we have in the world today is that if the whole world was doing it, would you be the one to stand up and say, no, that's not biblical? And think back to the days of Noah. Scripture says very clearly in the New Testament that in those days, the world was wicked. But Noah was a preacher of righteousness. It says that, I believe, in Peter. Noah, a preacher of righteousness back in his day. Wow. Now, we may get ideas in today's day that being a preacher of righteousness means we stand on a table in the cafe or the place we have lunch at in our workplaces and stand up and start convicting people and beating them over the head with the Bible. No. Actually, you just need to live it. Half the time, we just need to live what God's doing in us and letting that come out and letting that be a testimony. And when it's time to speak, it's time to speak. Amen? We better get moving here. Woo! So the more you follow the advice of the ungodly, the more you'll begin to see the world the way they do and eventually oppose God in his ways. You know, it's interesting when you look at this verse, there's a progression here. Okay? It says this, walk. Now imagine just walking with somebody, having casual conversation. My wife and I walk together about a 3-mile loop, and while we're walking, it's just not silent all the time. We're talking, we're having conversation. But we're on the move, we're going. Then it begins, then the progression goes walks, and then it stands, right? So now we're not just walking and talking, now we're standing, we're a little bit more intent on talking. And then it goes to from walking to standing to sitting. Now you're sitting at the table with them. Now you're connecting with them on a deeper level because community happens around the table. The Last Supper happened around a table. The table represents a place of intimacy. And so now you went from walking to standing to sitting. So it's not like you're going to wake up one morning and go, all of a sudden you're here walking with the Lord, then over here. And it just happened overnight. No, you progressively walk out of your relationship with the Lord and you walk into a worldview. Come on. That's why it's important to understand who we're hanging around with. Now, granted, we are called to be in the world. But being in the world doesn't mean that you're camping out and you're becoming like them. And doing what they do, being in the world means you're simply out there and you're loving people like Jesus would love them. It's really that simple. And the next thing you know, you're becoming one with that person or those people. But so let's look at this. The happy and full of joy Christian does have a biblical worldview because he delights, his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. So real quick, just the law there represents in the Old Testament the Torah. Sometimes it represented the first 5 books of the Bible, sometimes it meant represented others, but for the most part the Torah can actually be the whole Old Testament because it gets referred to as that as well. But the ultimate aim of that word there is not just the Torah, but it's multifaceted and it encompasses instruction, teaching, and direction. Okay, in the Torah, in God's word, there's direction. Can we say amen to that? There's teaching and there's instruction. How many of you know we need all three? Because they all work together with one another. So the psalmist here is saying, rather than following the advice of the wicked and the ways they live, the righteous person follows the instructions, direction of the Lord that we find in Scripture. Is this important to us today? Highly important, highly important. And then it goes on and says this. He meditates on it. He meditates on it. He meditates on it. Meditation on Scripture is critical. And I want to make this really simple. You know, whether you read the Bible in the morning, in the afternoon, or in the evening time before you go to bed, whatever time it is, before that next 24-hour cycle comes around, you have 24 hours to kind of chew on what you just read. And meditation, how many of you guys have heard of like cows chewing their cud? Okay, for those that were farmers once upon a time, you understand that. Simply means this, they chew, they swallow, don't get grossed out, then they puke it back up and they chew it some more. They swallow, puke it back up, chew some more. Doesn't sound very appealing, but that's chewing your cud. But it's a great illustration of how we're to take the Word of God and meditate on it. We're to chew on it. We're to swallow it, even the hard things. Come on, not just the good things, the hard things of it. We're to chew it and bring it back up and start meditating on it some more, chewing on it, swallowing it, bringing it back up. Come on. How many of you guys have dogs? Okay. Have you ever listened to your dog gnaw on a bone? Anyone? We used to have a boxer when I don't know what grade I was in, junior high or something like that. And we had it from a puppy, and that dog was fun. And it would have this toy that I would hold on to, and I'd wrestle around with it and stuff like that. And how many of you guys have ever seen that when you're doing that with your dog, how it just sits there and the whole body's involved, and it's just shaking it like that. And I'm laughing because I can pull that thing up. Woo! I can pull that thing up and hold a dog as it's like that. But the whole body is involved in trying to get that out of my hands. Here's another great picture of what we should do with the Word of God. We should chew on it and not let it go. We should chew on it with our whole being and not let it go. We should growl. That hurts. Right? Maybe let out a little whimper. Because I think one of the times I was doing that, one of the canines came out. It was a puppy, but the canine came out. It was his fault. But there's two great illustrations for us of understanding what it means to meditate on the Word. How easy it is, church, let's be honest today, how easy it is to just pick up your Word and just go through, and then walk away and do nothing with it. It's easy. We live in a world that's demanding more and more and more from us every day. Time is going fast. Expectations are higher and greater. And yet, sometimes as Christians, we just need to slow down and go, this is what's most important. Some time with the Lord. And I can meditate on what I read. And I would do this. I mean, if you have your reading plans, keep doing it. I'm a big proponent of just taking a few verses, reading it, and chewing on those. Because a lot of times if we feel like we have to do this reading plan or we're reading this much every day, there's not much meditation going on. Because because I've been there, you just read it so you can check the box that said you did it that day. And when you get into, you know, mixing Old Testament and New Testament, Psalms and New Testament, and then you get to like Psalms 119, you're like, gosh, it's going to take how much time to read all that? Come on. You know what I'm talking about. It's not just me. But sometimes that's what those reading schedules do, is it becomes more religion than it does set us free. Because it doesn't afford us time to sit there and really meditate on it. So read less, meditate on that more. Amen? Hebrews 4:12 says this, for the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joint and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of our heart. We read this last week in the introduction of last week, but it fits real well here. When we meditate on it, God's Spirit does something in us. He does surgery where surgery needs to, happen. He divides the flesh and the spirit, and something's going to take that spot. Right? Something's going to take when the Word of God comes in and it cuts, it makes space. What's going to fill that spot? Hopefully, it'll be the Word and His Spirit, not flesh again. Because flesh, it's up to us what's going to fill that spot. Okay? So happy and full of joy, Christian produces an unbending, able to stand in all circumstances without wavering life. Does that sound appealing to you? It says this, Psalms 1:3, it says, "He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth fruit in its season." I like what the NLT says. It says, "bearing fruit each season." Because we could look at that and go, well, it's not the season to have joy. Right? But the truth is, God is calling us to bear fruit in all seasons. "Whose leaf is also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper." And I know Deirdre had talked when I was in Alaska on rooting, planting, and growing, and did a magnificent job speaking on that. But there's something that happens when we allow the Word to transform our lives. There's something that happens when we allow the Word to change us, and our worldview comes from the Word and not from the world itself. It brings us to a place of getting planted. Come on. It brings us to a place of getting planted spiritually strong. And I was reading some time ago this story about back in the day when workmen, people that worked on building sailboats back in the day, and the mast, you know, the big one that's up in the middle where they attach the big sails on, and how they picked that piece of wood out, okay? Because this is long before technology, long before metal and all that kind of stuff. What they would do is they would go out to the forest and they would examine the trees, and when they found the one that they believed was the best one, this is what they did. They cleared all the trees out around it. Get the picture here. They cleared all the trees out around it and left it standing alone. Why did they do that? They did it because when it was protected by everything else, it was going to be weak. When a storm come, it would bend. It would lose. It wouldn't be as strong. So they cleared everything out and allowed the storms to test it and try it and make it stronger. Because they didn't need a mast that would fall or collapse when the storms came. Because understand, when you put a sail up and big winds come, it puts a lot of pressure on that. And that it's got to be able to sustain that. But that's a great picture of what God wants to do with us. Come on, He wants us strong. He wants us to come to our place where we're planted by the water, that whenever storms come, we can handle it. Why? Because we've been tested. We've been proven. And you don't get to that place unless you go through storms. You don't get to that place unless you go through some difficulty. That's the only way our faith grows. Faith does not grow osmosively. It doesn't grow because we go, "Ugh, my faith just grew." It grows because God brings it from infancy to maturity. And the only way to do that is to go through difficulty. The only way to do that is to be tested and tried. And when we're tested and we failed, that's not a failure. It just reveals to us that we're not there. And then we can go back on our face before God and say, "Lord, grow me, grow my faith. Help me come to this place where I'm absolutely in trust with you, because you are the only thing that's worthy to be trusted. I can't trust in myself. I can't trust in my own efforts, because that's going to fail. All I have is to trust in you. Father, forgive me for not trusting in this situation. Forgive me for getting my eyes onto the situation and not onto your goodness. Because God is a good God. And he's not out looking to destroy you. He's out actually to mature you to be the children of God that he's looking for in the world today. And the only way to be that way is to trust him in all the seasons of your life that you go through, and that you'll be planted next to the river, and not just a river, but the river of living water, the Word of God, the Holy Spirit, all working in conjunction together to bring, you can come up, to bring, we didn't talk before service, but to bring about what God's looking to bring about in our life. How many of you would love to be planted deep, solid? Whatever comes your way, there's not a shift, not a worldly thinking of God doesn't love me, not a worldly thinking of, well, if God was good, he would, and fill in the blank. That's a worldview, not a biblical worldview. See, a biblical worldview goes, Lord, this is really tough. This is a tough situation I'm in. And Lord, I'm afraid. But Lord, I know you're good. Lord, I'm afraid. But I remember back last year when I was in another storm. You showed up. I didn't die there. You brought me through it. Lord, you're the same God that's going to bring it through, bring me through now. And it stands there, not convinced that God's a bad person, not convinced that he's out to destroy you, but your view is this: God, you're so good, and you're growing me to be more like you. You're growing me to stand the test of time that come my way. You're growing me for maybe something different that's coming down the road. You're growing me. I don't know about you, but I didn't like it when I got disciplined growing up. It was only once, but I didn't like it. Don't throw up, mom and dad. I didn't like it. Nobody likes it. How many of you like discipline when you're a child? I know the older back you go, it wasn't the belt, it was the switch. And you had to go pick it yourself. And it better be green, because if it was brittle, you're going to go pick a bigger one. I've heard the stories. Many of you younger people don't understand discipline anymore. Literally, they had to go out by a sapling tree, cut off a branch that was flexible, strip it all down, and that was used on the back of the legs. It felt good, is what I heard. It's what I heard. But nobody likes that. But usually when I got the belt, that's what I got, was the belt. And even saying that, CPS is going, oh, I wish I would have known, right? Dear Lord, let us discipline our children. Our schools might be healthier. I remember the days of being in junior high and high school, they still did the hack paddle. And you know what? You only have to get hacked once by the principal, which is like really bad if you had to go to the principal. And I'm just, because I heard these things, right? You don't want to go back to the principal again and get hacked. I had a teacher that had holes drilled in his hack paddle, so we get more speed. And of course, that was done in front of the whole class, right? So we're going to shame you into obeying, right? Is from what I heard. But nobody likes that. God's not disciplining us to be mean. He's not growing us to be mean. He's doing it because he has plans for you. And those plans require an absolute trust in who he is. But the only way you're going to have that is to consume that word, to meditate on it, to study it, to consume it. That's the only way we're going to get there. And here's the thing, church, I can't do it for you. You have to do it yourself. Just like you can't do it for me. Only you get to determine what you're going to do with this. Only you get to determine how you're going to be set free. You get to determine whether the fullness of what Christ paid for on the cross is going to be evident in your life, or you're going to settle for half of it, or a part of it, or one part of it. Maybe it's just heaven you want. Maybe that's what you want to focus on. Well, it's going to make for a miserable life. And odds are you won't make it to the end, because you'll probably renounce Christ before you get there. Listen, we live in a day and an age where we've got to let this consume us, where we let this change us and transform us. Like Jesus when he was transfigured on the mount with Peter, James, and John. If you look that word up, it means metamorphosis is what the word we get out of it for that. When we read this, God's expectation is a metamorphosis of our life into his life. That's what this will do. It will change your life. And it won't be just something that you say different. It will be every component of your entire being will be set free by this word. That will be set free because of the work of the cross. That will be set free as the Holy Spirit is working in you. And as I said last week, our job is simple, but hard. All we have to do is surrender to it. All we have to do is surrender to the working of the Holy Spirit as he works the word through every component of our life. Down deep in those areas where you struggle and probably are in bondage to, he wants to get down there and he wants to liberate you by the word of God, by the blood of the Lamb. He wants to get in there and set you free so the fullness of the cross is evident in your life, where there's no things hanging on, no dead corpses dragging behind us as everywhere we go, leaving off a stench. You know, we want new wine, right? But let's not keep giving the world old wine. I don't know about you, but if you've ever drinking bad grape juice, it don't taste good. And the world doesn't need any more Christians giving a bad taste or leaving a bad taste in their mouth. What they need is the new wine of God's Spirit doing a work in us coming out. They need to see a river of living water coming out of us, not the old man or the old woman that's in us. It says this in Psalms 119:35. He says, make me walk along the paths of your commands, for that is where my happiness is found. That is where my joy is found. And then we'll close with this. James 1:22-25. But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourself. See, when we hear the word and we don't do it, we deceive ourselves. Woo! That's exciting, right? For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law or the perfect word of liberty and continues in it and is not forgetful, a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the word, this one will be blessed in what he does. Maybe we don't see blessing in our life. Whew. Because we're only hearers. Ow. And again, blessing doesn't mean that there's not storms. But maybe we just don't see what we want because we're only a hearer and not a doer. Maybe we're only a reader and not a meditator. Come on. Church, there is so much more. And the goodness of God sits there waiting for hungry children to say, I want all of you. I want all of you. I want less of me and all of you. I want this old life gone and I want that new wine in its fullness. I want the old things to pass away and I want to see the new things come in. Come on. God is good. God is patient. God is graceful and he's merciful. And we could probably go from this side of the room at Craig and go over to this side of the room with Jordan, and we probably all have things that a holy God would say, I don't like that. I want it out because it's holding you back from being all that I've called you to be. And sometimes those things in our life are the very things that take our joy away. Come on. Those are the things that take our happiness, which brings us to a place of living a life of joy. Church, God is good. And his best intention is for you because you are the prize and the apple of his eye, and he has the best intentions for you, but you've got to want it. And sometimes the wanting brings us to a place where he's going to tear some things down. But the pain of having things torn down will bring forth a tree, come on, a tree that will be planted by the river of living water, where the word is transforming and making stronger. The roots will go down deeper. It can stand anything that can be shaken. And I know Jesus said this, that everything in the end times will be shaken. Everything. The strongest of people in Christ will be shaken. So that means all of humanity will be shaken by what will happen. So if we're going to be shaken anyways, why don't we be strong in the Lord, in the power of his might? Why don't we be strong in his word? Why don't our worldview shift from a secular to a biblical worldview? And how we view everything that's happening in the world. May it come from the heart of God. Because when we have a biblical worldview, you can't hate the people that are doing things in the world. You love the people that are doing things in the world that aren't good. Why? Because Jesus would do just that. Let's stand. Father, we thank you that you are good. Lord, you're so good and you're so merciful, and it doesn't take us that long to go back in days sometimes just to see how good you are and how patient you are with us. But Father, may we have that hunger for your word that changes us. Father, we desire, and I'm going to pray this for all of us, we desire a transformed life. By the power of your word, the blood of the Lamb, come on, in your Holy Spirit that resides in us. Father, help us to surrender in all the areas that we need to surrender in and embrace a little pain for the freedom that is priceless, the freedom that we didn't even pay for, that you paid for us. Help us, Father. And I just want to encourage you. If you're here today and you're going through some things, we want to pray for you. We want to stand with you. We want to come alongside you. Because you're not meant to do this alone. You're meant to do this with the body of Christ. There's no judgment here. I said it last week. There's no judgment here. Because all of us are judged by somebody, somehow, some way. And it's not right. But if you want to be set free, then you got to start stepping into it. Sometimes stepping into it is bringing stuff out of the darkness and into the light. So we're going to open up the altars. If you need prayer for anything, we invite you to come. There'll be people here to pray for you. Father, we thank you. May your hands be on us this week. Help us to meditate on your word and allow it to change us. In Jesus' name, amen.